This video is sponsored by CuriosityStream. Hey, hey, Marcus House with you here. Well, this has been a pretty exciting week. With FAA approval given, SN9's test flight campaign was go for launch, and that amazing moment full of excitement and bewilderment soon followed. Really exciting news from SpaceX this week with the announcement that towards the end of the year, a Falcon 9 is going to launch a fully commercial crewed mission called Inspiration 4, and it seems that Sirius XM7 has a serious problem with their orbital test not going to plan.
So
yes, look, I know it's taken a long time for SN9 to fly with a bunch of delays, but damn was it worth the wait. Remember, all of these prototype flights are gearing up to that ultimate goal of sending humans to Mars. There are always going to be a few stumbles along the way. Very late in the evening on Monday, approval was finally gained so that SpaceX could proceed with the launch. They then began preparations for the local area's population to be evacuated on Tuesday, ahead of potential flight attempts later in the day, ending more than a week of delays and a significant FAA licensing issue. So then that amazing launch day came, with SN9 looking to match the success of SN8's flight, with the ultimate prize being a smooth touchdown on the landing pad. However, that was not quite what we saw. Not that this will be news to anyone that follows SpaceX closely, but SN9 suffered a similar fate to its predecessor. The flight itself performed flawlessly for almost 6.5 minutes before an engine relight issue led to a hard landing and an energetic, rapid, unscheduled disassembly. All was actually trending well for a 2 p.m. launch, however, a range violation delayed the launch to 24 minutes past the hour. There it was, the ignition and gigantic plume of exhaust and dust. SN9 gracefully lifted off the launch stand and rode the pillar of fire, with those three Raptor engines flawlessly hurling the vehicle into the Texas sky. As Starship ascended, one engine was shut down, followed soon by the second. That was normal, of course, and was done to reduce the overall thrust to weight ratio as the tanks emptied out, just like with SN8. Once it reached its maximum altitude of 10 kilometers, which is just a little over 6 miles, it hovered for a short time, completing a tank handoff where the Raptor engine's source of propellant was transferred from the main tanks to the header tanks, ready for that flip maneuver. The reaction control system started firing and aero surfaces started maneuvering into position to transition the vehicle into that horizontal skydive position to complete the subsonic portion of the flight. The aft and forward flaps were then utilized to hold the vehicle's stability for a controlled descent back to the landing site. So as the Starship approached the landing pad, the intention was that two of the Raptors would fire up to bring SN9 back to its vertical position. However, this did not go to plan, as one of the two Raptors failed to ignite correctly. Because that second engine failed to light up, the ship was not able to stop its rotation from belly flop to vertical, which led the vehicle losing control and crashing on its leeward side at around 200 kilometers per hour. RGV aerial photography planned a flyover as soon as the temporary flight restrictions ended, providing the community with stunning footage of the wreckage right after the event. This is all due to the support that you all provide on his YouTube and Patreon, so thanks so much for allowing Mauricio to do what he does here. The community, I think, would just be lost without these awesome perspectives. So yes, as SN9 impacted the ground at a much higher velocity than SN8, the debris spread far and wide. Now, as it was only one Raptor that failed to ignite, with the other one providing good thrust all the way to the ground, we can assume that it was just an issue with that single Raptor and not a low-pressure header tank issue as we saw with SN8, meaning that they hopefully mitigated that specific issue. Now, there is some info that we can take away from SpaceX's footage here of the flip maneuver that could explain why that single engine failed to reignite. There's actually a couple of items that have been seen to be blown out of the skirt during the flip, but it's unknown at this point if that had anything to do with the landing failure itself. Also, we can actually see flames at the head of the engine that failed. All in all, though, without any solid proof from Elon or SpaceX, this is very much looking like an engine failing and coming apart. As we saw there with SN9, if one of the two Raptors failed to ignite, then there is no way to recover, which ultimately led to SN9's failed landing. Just recently, Elon Musk agreed with this and tweeted that it would be foolish of them to not start three engines and then immediately shut down one. This would mean that if one fails, that they still have the other two Raptors to carry out the flip maneuver and land successfully. That decision would automatically be decided based on the available data right after the relight. He also added that if three engines are good, then the engine with the least lever arm would shut down. Now, the lever arm in question is the relationship of the engines to the vehicle and its direction of motion, which in this case would be towards the ground. Brenton created a diagram to explain this more clearly, to which Elon immediately gave the thumbs up on. These changes are going to be implemented into SN10's test flight, and with that extra redundancy, we hope to see a successful landing next time. As SpaceX's webcast host and engineer John Inspruker noted by the company's live coverage, the primary purpose of SN9 was to gather as much data as possible throughout the subsonic flight. Starship will need to be comfortable during this part of the flight in order to reliably perform these unorthodox skydiver-style landings. Thankfully, there was no damage to the tank farm either, which should allow SN10 to continue through preparations to launch later on this month. Hopefully, this time the testing campaign is much more streamlined compared to its two predecessors, SN8 and SN9, who spent much more time on the pad than was really expected. Things are looking better for SN10, which has already been obviously rolled to the pad and has also undergone an ambient nitrogen test that verified that the vehicle is sound and leak-free. The ultimate hope, of course, is that SN10 will undergo a single static fire before its own flight. This, however, was also the plan for SN9, which ended up having multiple engine swaps and a total of 6 static fires. Late on Monday, preparation for SN10's Raptor installation was taking place, with a single Raptor engine being moved to the pad. SN10 also has a greater number of those thermal protection system heat shield tiles than SN9 did, as SpaceX works to gain even more data on the performance during launch and landing. Now, I just wanted to share with you a little teaser of this beautiful video released this week by Cosmic Perspective on Starship SN9's attempted landing. This just blew me away. The quality of this and the music and emotion is just breathtaking. It's all output in super high resolution as well, much higher than you're seeing here, so do yourself a favor and check it out from the link in the description, and be sure to follow the team there as well. There is a lot more footage coming from Cosmic Perspective. So over to news at the build site. At present, the entire section of the booster number one's liquid oxygen tank has now been stacked. This section here we see will be stacked on top of the methane tank. Thank you as always to the incredible Boca Chica gal with NASA spaceflight capturing these details in between the excitement, of course, of the main flight. Early in the week as well, the common dome for this same booster prototype was moved outside and then flipped to its correct orientation. The massive 18-ring tall section that is currently in the high bay will be stacked on top of this common dome to enclose and complete the liquid oxygen tank section. Along with that, its after dome was also rolled outside, ready to be sleeved. Now, in the lead up to the flight, we also saw SN15's forward dome lifted into the mid bay, which was then stacked on top of its common dome. We also saw the sleeving of an aft dome, presumably we think for SN16. Its nose cone barrel was also spotted earlier in the week as well. So to sum up, of course, we have Brendan's awesome diagram for the week showing all of these updates and more. If you want to keep updated with all things Starship and space news, please do consider subscribing and taking a second to tap that like button. There is loads more updates and live streams coming very soon with Starship serial number 10 and Super Heavy prototypes, and I'd love to share all that with you. So yes, now we all await SN10 for our next fix for the Starship flight. The attention has already shifted to this flight and the likelihood of a successful landing where SN8 and SN9 bit the dust. That leads us to some new unbelievable work from Neopork, providing the most detailed textured models. There is a very good reason why I so frequently refer to the naked Starship renders such as this one we see here, or some of the belly flop renders that just look so realistic. It is the closest thing to a real photograph that I have seen so far. With all of this crazy stuff rendered in Autodesk Maya for modeling, Arnold Render for rendering images and animations, and also ZBrush or ZBrush for organic modeling like rocks and creatures. He is a real pro at this too, with experience in Maya going back almost 15 years and ZBrush for a decade. So yes, until March of 2020, less than a year ago now, he had never once modeled a rocket, but wow, has that changed to what we see here now. He had stumbled on and was inspired by the works going on by Raphael, Kimi and Casper Stanley, and then he was just hooked. And since then, this has been the result, the continuous series of beautiful artwork that we've been promoting here on the channel ever since that time. Now, he mostly enjoys the constant pursuit of realism, and we can really tell. These realistic models, of course, are notoriously difficult because us humans are so good at spotting things that look just a little too perfect or move in an unrealistic way. Over the course of the year, though, it is getting harder and harder to distinguish these renders from reality. But as he says, there is always a way to do better and take it one level higher. So yes, Neopork found this new inspiration as an artist for the very first time with this community. And believe me when I say, you have inspired us, mate. Not only that, you've inspired a string of other artists to follow in your passion. He is also working on some really exciting new projects that he's pouring a load of time into, and also some new collaborative efforts with other artists that could turn out to be pretty special. So stay tuned for that by following his Twitter and supporting via Patreon where you can. I just can't wait to see what is coming. The links to those are in the description. Now, some really exciting news from SpaceX this week as well, with the announcement that towards the end of this year, a Falcon 9 is going to launch a mission called Inspiration 4. This is going to be the very first time that a fully commercial mission is launched into orbit by SpaceX. Commercial, of course, meaning that this is in no part a government mission. This is going to be for all commercial astronauts. How cool is that? Now, obviously, in 2020, SpaceX enabled the United States to again send humans back to space from American soil. That is a big achievement of its own and not to be downplayed, but this new milestone will add a new feather to SpaceX's cap, with the founder and CEO of Shift 4 Payments, Jared Isaacman, to fly on board the Crew Dragon vessel. Alongside him will be three seats to fill up as well. He is actually going to be giving these three places to people that will be selected and announced in weeks ahead. There is more information on how this will be selected on the Inspiration4.com website, where it says that the spots are open to legal US residents 18 years and older. Now, this really is the start of what we are going to see more frequently. Loads of tourism missions heading up all the time, not just the lucky few government-assigned astronauts. The four crew, once selected, are going to be receiving astronaut training by SpaceX themselves around the workings of the Falcon 9 launch vehicle and the Crew Dragon, and that is going to also cover everything from operating in zero-G, orbital mechanics, and much, much more. There is a great deal to learn. Everything from using the spacesuits, emergency procedures, and mission simulations. What an incredible experience that this would be. I just can't wait to see who is selected for this flight. All we really know at this stage about the mission itself is that it's going to be multiple days, and we can assume that it'll be a typical low Earth orbit. Concluding the mission, of course, will be the epic Earth re-entry and water landing near Florida's coast. Now, things are definitely ramping up for 2021, with SpaceX showing that they are serious about achieving that 40 or more launches. On February 3rd, it looked like we were going to see a double-header Starlink mission just 4 hours apart with two separate launches, but one was obviously pushed back with the extra time needed to gather additional ground data. Instead, we saw a single Starlink mission with the 60 satellites there safely stowed away inside the fairings. The weather was perfect with this launch attempt, and as if two Starships side-by-side this week wasn't enough, just take a look at this picture here with Pad 39A at Kennedy Space Center occupied as well. So yes, at T0, the nine Merlin engines roared to life, hoisting the vehicle skyward on Thursday, February 4th at 1:19 a.m. We saw there the main engine cutoff, the second stage separation, just beautiful views there of the second stage lighting up the first stage grid fins there. Also great as well to see the telemetry readings for both stages 1 and 2 at the same time. That is a nice touch there that we haven't typically seen before. I hope that that is going to become a regular change. Now, this was a tough landing too, with Elon tweeting here saying that it was a tricky one due to high winds and seas. All the same, it was another perfect bullseye from the Falcon 9 booster. Terrific work there. Now back to the payload, and there was a coast phase to complete before a quick 1 second engine firing as it passed by my neighborhood here, with Tasmania getting a quick mention from Kate in the stream. And there we go, deployment there of the payload in yet another seamless mission. Once again, SpaceX making it look too easy when we know full well that it is not. Now, in conclusion to this segment, I've just got to say wow here from this breathtaking clip of the Falcon 9 flying right through the view of the moon here. Now, if you are not subscribed to Trevor here on YouTube, you are missing out. There is huge preparation to get a shot like this. Well done, mate. The link to that video is in the description. Go check it out. Some news has emerged recently from SiriusXM and Maxar Technologies that the satellite launched by SpaceX in December last year has encountered failures with some of the payload units during in-orbit testing. We'll talk more about that in a moment, but before that, a big thank you to CuriosityStream for sponsoring this video. Now, this amazing subscription streaming service provides thousands of award-winning documentaries. Of course, if you're anything like me, the space-related content such as this great documentary talking about the Mars Perseverance rover will catch your eye immediately. This episode of Breakthrough lets us meet Perseverance in greater detail. This is NASA's latest rover, and it is a beast. As it heads towards the groundbreaking re-entry into the atmosphere of Mars, we are closer to researching that big question: did life once exist on the red planet? Ancient rivers and vast lakes, now gone, may hold the silent signs of past life, but that silence may well soon be broken. The Perseverance rover is about to be hunting for Martian life, and that is a story that I can't wait to see play out. Now, I've been a subscriber to CuriosityStream for a long time, and I've loved so many of the documentaries and series offered here. Now, if space content isn't your thing, perhaps you're interested in history, nature, food, travel, science and technology, there are many great libraries here for you to explore, and you can even stream this incredible content worldwide anytime on a range of supported devices. If you would like to help support me and would like to check it out, give it a try by heading to curiositystream.com/MarcusHouse. With that, you can sign up for access at just $14.99 for the entire year. You'll find that link in the description below. Now, as far as we know, the issues with SiriusXM 7 has nothing to do with the performance of the Falcon 9 itself. It seems instead like the satellite itself has had a failure of the payload units. The reason why this has happened or the extent of the damage is currently unknown, yet SiriusXM hopes to be able to recover the satellite and continue operations. The launch itself was originally, of course, delayed from December 11th in 2020, and SpaceX sent SiriusXM to a geostationary orbit a few days later on the 13th. This is just one of a pair of very high-powered digital audio radio satellites with XM8 set to launch later this year. It was Maxar Technologies who built the XM7 satellite. So yes, in no way have these issues been attributed to the SpaceX launch vehicle in any way. That performed its role perfectly. So the issues are of course under investigation, but they're not going to impact the business operations or the other operational satellites belonging to the company. XM7 was meant to provide 15 years or more of serviceability working in conjunction with the current fleet of SiriusXM satellites. This particular satellite apparently had an insurance policy valued at $225 million. That not only included the launch phase and the deployment, but it also included the first entire year of operation. That just goes to show right there how expensive these satellites are. Just compare that for a moment of the launch cost of the Falcon 9, which last we heard sits at around $50 million when launched with a reused booster like this one was. That means that the insurance policy alone there is worth over four times the entire launch vehicle. That seems pretty nuts to me. I guess this is a good reminder that insurance for not only the launch but the operational period is very important. So Maxar have stated that they're assisting Sirius with investigations despite having already handed over the satellite after launch. We do hope that they find a way to salvage the situation and can quickly determine what happened, all while of course XM8 is still being built. Now, we are huge supporters of the transition to electric vehicles here on the channel, and our partner EV offers the ability for travellers in Australia to rent an electric vehicle and tour the country in style. Also, if you have an electric vehicle in Australia, you can earn money when you're not using your car by sharing it with others. If any of that sounds interesting to you, the link is in the description. Huge thanks to my amazing patrons and YouTube members here. The support that you are all providing allows us to increase the time that we can spend, and that is all thanks to the growing list of supporters. Thank you to each and every one of you. As support increases, that just helps the entire team. So if you like what we're doing and you'd like to join us, head to patreon.com/MarcusHouse, or alternatively, you can join up as a YouTube member. That gives you access to interact with me more directly via the linked roles on our Discord server. You can have your name listed right here like all of these other amazing people, and you can also have earlier access to watch these videos before anyone else. Massive thank you as well to the production crew assisting greatly with video production, and of course to the quality control squad here for helping me research and proof the material for all of these videos. If all of this interests you and you'd like to be a part of it, follow me on Twitter and please do get in touch. In the tile in the bottom left today, we have my video last week talking about all things SpaceX with Starship and Transporter 1. We show off some brilliant work by Corey and talk a little about Boeing Starliner's next launch attempt. In the top right is my latest video, in the bottom right, content that YouTube has selected from my channel just for you. Thank you everyone for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video.